I'm Judy Umaki, and this is Video Voters Guide, a service of the League of Women Voters, a 100-year-old nonpartisan organization that believes democracy depends on informed and active participation. For more election information, be sure to visit our online site, Vote 411, before you mark your ballot. Today we have Kurt Schrader, candidate for United States House of Representatives from the district. Good afternoon, Kurt. Tell us about your background and why you decided originally to run and now to run for re-election for the U.S. Senate, I mean Congress, and how has the coronavirus pandemic affected your campaign?
Well, as you alluded to, I'm the current congressman from Oregon's 5th Congressional District. I run some of the Central Oregon coast, Lincoln and Tillamook counties, through Marion and Polk County in the Mid-Willamette Valley, and gets most of Clackamas County with a smidge of Benton and a very tiny piece of Multnomah County. Background, I've been in business for myself for over 30 years as a veterinarian. We treated dogs, cats, and horses. Love that work. Started a small organic farm at our place in Canby with my family. Four kids did a great, great job, great opportunity to raise them in a great environment. Spent a stint in the Oregon State Legislature as a state representative, then a state senator, was in charge of the budget for the state of Oregon when I was there. Felt like our experience in the small business, raising a family, and my legislative experience put me in a good position to be a good representative for the United States Congress for that district. That's a very balanced district with diverse opinions, diverse geography, diverse socioeconomics, and feel I've done a really good job of representing them. Like to be elected for reason, judge one of the most effective leaders in the United States Congress. And given the diversity of the district, frankly, there are very few members I think that could represent it as well. We're $1.5 million to seniors, veterans, and others that have missed out on government programs they've earned over the years. We've brought projects back to the district. We're closely with Newport to bring the NOAA fleet down. When we first got elected as a very new member, very successful. We were instrumental in getting the Woodburn Interchange fixed, providing infrastructure for Mill Creek, where Amazon now resides in the great city of Salem, Oregon, and making 205 a highway of national significance. And frankly, we're coming from Oregon with our leadership in the state legislature on healthcare, education, and climate issues. I figured this would be a great opportunity for me to showcase what we do in Oregon and represent us well and hopefully bring the nation along.
Extreme levels of political polarization have, you're well aware, created a toxic atmosphere in Washington, D.C. in recent years. What steps have you taken and will you take to work with members of the opposite party to pass needed legislation?
Well, that's our stock and trade, Judy. We're known as one of the more bipartisan legislators in the entire United States Congress. I, like many people back home, was fed up when I first got there with the extreme partisanship. It did not lead to productive results. The dialogue, frankly, offensive. There was a lack of courtesy and common decorum. And it's fine, like we do in Oregon, to disagree, but you do it in an agreeable way. And that was lacking in the United States Congress. So I personally formed a group called the Problem Solvers Caucus. I did this about 6 years ago. I teamed up with a Republican buddy of mine from Wisconsin, Reed Ribble, and put out feelers for members that actually wanted to work together to get something done. You could be very liberal, you could be very conservative, you could be moderate. The only criteria basically was that you wanted to get stuff done. That group has grown to nearly 40 strong, over 40 strong. I think we're close to 50 now, 25 Democrats, 25 Republicans. We discussed these issues. We had a huge success just last summer when they had the crush at the southern border, all these folks from Central America coming to hopefully find a better life, escape persecution in those Central American countries, trying to figure out what to do there. There was a log jam and the humanitarian aid package of over $4 billion to put not walls down there, but to put judges, attorneys, better living facilities, family care, passed in large part because we as the Problem Solvers Group, Republicans and Democrats together said, we want this package, we want to have that now. So that's the way I operate. That's the way we're being able to be so successful. We did it with the wildfire funding bill here. We've done it in the Affordable Care Act, even with the Republicans objecting initially, trying to bring them along. Long storied history of bipartisan legislation, being progressive and effective at the same time.
Under the Trump administration, economic interests have taken priority over science-based steps to lessen the impact of climate change. Do you agree with this direction? And if not, how will you work to change it?
No, I don't agree with that direction. What is very sad is the President of the United States does not even allow anybody in his administration to use the word climate change. It's absurd, putting your head in the ground, denying what everyone can see around us, the wildfires we see in Oregon every summer, every summer, and sometimes horrifically. Remember that Gorge fire just a couple of years ago? I've been a leader in the United States Congress in trying to figure out how do we keep our forests healthy? How do we put folks in those rural communities to work to keep the forests healthy? It's a win-win situation. We partnered with Senator Wyden Senator Crapo, as well as Representative Simpson, both Republicans, to come up with a wildfire disaster fund bill. We were able to get that through the United States Congress, where the Forest Service no longer now has to spend half its budget fighting fires. We have a disaster fund for that now, just like we had disaster funds for hurricanes and floods. Now we can use that for and the Forest Service now can go out and do healthy forest management, keep our fires from getting out of control, promote a much healthier environment. I'm also working with a good Republican friend of mine from West Virginia, believe it or not, on reducing power plant emissions to near zero by 2050. We've got a plan that over the next 10 years will put us on a trajectory to get those emissions down. And not many people can do that. This is the only bipartisan bill in the United States Congress that has a chance of passing to reduce our carbon emissions. And of course, I've been at this a long time. When I was in the state legislature, ocean acidification was just coming into vogue as a term. We were seeing it on the Central Oregon coast. Whiskey Hull Hatchery, responsible for a lot of the shellfish, oyster larvae out there for our beloved industry, was under big siege because of that. We worked closely with Mark Weigert and Oregon State University to find out what the heck was going on. It was a harbinger of some of the climate issues we see here today. So that and many other issues, we're pushing science. I think that's the way to treat as a veterinarian steeped in science. That's the only way to approach these issues.
If elected, what do you think should be prioritized in helping constituents deal with the ongoing and wide-ranging impacts of the coronavirus? How do you think federal legislation like the CARES Act will affect health care and protections for the environment, employees, and business and elections? Do Oregonians win or lose?
Well, hopefully we win on balance. I'm proud to be a member of this particular Congress at this particular time, where we stepped up in record time. Within a week of Oregon's first case of coronavirus, we passed our first coronavirus aid, close to $10 billion, most of it going for treatment, diagnostics, vaccine development for the coronavirus, helping out our healthcare providers, our community health centers, getting the start of the personal protective gear, equipment that we need so much. And within 10 days after that, we passed another huge package that showed our priorities. We were going to do family leave, we're going to do sick leave, we're going to do tax credits for small business employers so they could do those two things and make sure children had nutrition even as schools closed around the country. That if you'd have told me prior to this that Congress, Republicans and Democrats from across this country could agree on that, I told you you're crazy. But in a crisis, your Congress has stepped up, and I'm proud to be part of that. The most recent example is 10 days after that, we passed this CARES package. It does not target just the big business out there. Frankly, with the addition of the work that we're doing right now in Congress, small businesses are going to get over $600 billion out of this for a paycheck protection program, for economic injury disaster loans. We do unemployment. We make sure there's an initial check that hopefully folks are getting as we speak to help them through this very tough period if they've lost their job or facing reduced hours right now. There's childcare in this bill. There's parts of the bill to deal with homelessness, trying to give renter assistance, making sure it's not just about the homeowner, but those folks that rent out there, preventing evictions from federal housing, a whole panoply of very, very important things, I think, that are critical to hopefully shoring up our system, the small businesses in particular that don't have reserves. I lived that life for 30 years. I know you live paycheck to paycheck. You take care of your employees. And it's tough to do. And when you're shut down or people are afraid to come to your business, it's really difficult. So these programs that hopefully will be kicking in here soon, some have already gotten assistance. We've had some rough starts, but it's getting better. I think will be a lifeline to a lot of folks. That's where the focus of my attention is right now. The campaign is on the back burner. I'm sure that's breaking the heart of millions of Oregonians, but it's appropriate. You know, this is something we need to be dealing with. Calls I usually make to try and raise money in this horrible post-Citizens United world now turn into calls checking in with people. How are you? How's it going? How are the construction workers faring these days? You know, what's your small business doing? What's the North Clackamas Chamber of Commerce seeing? You know, what are these people dealing with? What are my constituents? What's happening to my lawn utilities? That's the calls that I'm making now, Judy. It's unfortunately, campaign's pretty much on the back burner. Hopefully, interviews like this give the voters at least a little information.
That's great. Kurt, thanks so much for talking with us today. Stay safe, and voters, don't forget to visit Vote 411 for personalized ballot information.